Well, good morning, everyone. We have a lot of fun announcements this morning and some updates on critical things that the city is working on in my administration. But let's start with Spokane Gives. It is an awesome Monday. The weather was also awesome this weekend, and it was a great turnout over the weekend for some of our key projects that kicked off the Spokane Gives Week. I participated in cleaning from the core with my family here at right here at Riverfront Park, actually. My kids have now decided that every spring they clean the carousel. And they're very excited about their free ride on the carousel after 3 hours of work polishing the carousel. I don't know whether that's a free ride or not, but there was over 400 volunteers in our core, and really twice as many as we had last year. And it really is a focus on cleaning the center of our city and really our downtown, our community gathering place for so many festivals that will start this spring and really the spring in Spokane. We're off to a great start. My family was getting dressed this morning to participate in more activities and really to show Spokane once again our compassion and our goal to be one of the most compassionate cities in America. We do have a full week of volunteer opportunities. Over 100 organizations are participating with different events happening each and every day, culminating this coming Saturday. What's even more exciting is that half of those events have already reached their volunteer capacity, but there still is capacity left, and I invite people to go to SpokaneGives.org and see the great things that are happening every day. You know, every day more and more groups are coming on board, people are asking about it, and our corporate philanthropy continues to amaze me. Today, joining me is Marty Dickinson from Sterling, soon to be Umpqua, who really joined as a key partner with Windermere and STCU and others. But today, I wanted to recognize the efforts of Sterling early on as someone who is giving our mini grant program that allows our nonprofits that don't have the resources to put to some of these small events that were happening, and they can apply for up to $500 through the United Way to really kick those off. This year, 14 mini grant applications have been approved. The Spokane AIDS Network is one of the first recipients and will reuse that grant money to pay for materials to repair a wood railing and stairs on their fire escape. Gay Weiss is here today. She is the executive director of Spokane AIDS Network and a great advocate for that organization. She always is getting me to be in different runs and different events that she is hosting. And she is still looking and for volunteers. The event will happen this Saturday to build that. My family will be down there. She's one of my neighbors. Others include support for the Boy Scouts tree planting project, the purchase of school supplies through the communities and schools, youth outreach activities, and cleanup along the Spokane River. And so that grant pool was key to making those happen. And again, agencies can apply for those grants through the Spokane United Way. The mini grants are just another way that Spokane is giving back to help those that need a hand up. Many of the grants enable additional volunteer opportunities, creating a ripple effect throughout the community. Marty Dickinson is here this morning representing Sterling, and I just give her a moment to talk about their commitment, which has been generations and really a corporate philosophy of that organization, and again, highlights the amazing partnerships that we're building in Spokane Gives.
Good morning, everybody. Well, again, Sterling, soon to be Umpqua Bank by this Friday. And, you know, Sterling has been with this community and will continue to be with this community as Umpqua Bank. We have a community foundation that is being formed, and things like these micro grants that we have been able to do through Spokane Gives, through our Connect program, which is having each one of our associates be given paid time to volunteer in their communities to help kids that need assistance, to help communities. All of those things are what is coming through the merger of Sterling and Umpqua, and we are really, really happy to be a part of this great opportunity with the mayor and with the city of Spokane, and we will continue to be a partner to this community. So thank you so much for giving us the opportunity.
With that, if we could have Ms. Weiss, the executive director, just tell us a little bit about what this grant allows you to do that you haven't been able to do before.
Perfect.
Thank you, and thank you to Sterling and to the mayor. The mayor has adopted our project. Thank you very much. We live in a very old Victorian home on South Hill. Without this mini grant, we would not be able to do the work that we're able to do. Many people want to volunteer. Volunteers also need supplies to do that work, and this has put those two partnerships together to make this happen. We have many other opportunities at Spokane AIDS Network. Check out on the United Way website and the Spokane Gives to look for other opportunities. So thank you to this community and to our partners for making this happen. Thanks so much.
Well, there we go. Clap, thank you over there. So again, they join Windermere Real Estate, STCU, the Spokane United Way, and the Empire Health Foundation, who have stepped forward this year, and all of our local media and the great support that they've given this and really will do throughout the week. But in the end, it is the nonprofits and other community organizations themselves who came forward, put together projects for this week to re-engage our community. Everyone from Second Harvest to Spokane Public Schools were first amongst to jump on board. You know, they committed to this challenge, and it still is not too late to get involved. People can volunteer this week, every week, by going to SpokaneGives.org. My ultimate goal, the goal of everyone who is sponsoring, organizing, or volunteering, is to show Spokane is the most compassionate community, not just for one week, but around the throughout the year. Spokane Gives Week is about shining the light on volunteering and promoting volunteerism year-round. This week and every week is a great week to volunteer in our city. Thank you very much for being here with us this morning, and look forward to seeing you out there this week. All right, now on to the next event, and that is an update on the Ombudsman Commission and the implementation of our transparency and oversight of our police department. If I could have the city attorney join me, that would be great. Bikers in parks, don't worry, we're still, this is a busy, it must be everybody's getting gearing up in the spring. We have a lot of announcements. But the city attorney, Nancy Isserlis, is joining me just as a quick update on where we are in furthering the implementation of the Ombudsman Commission. Continuing our theme of public engagement, I'm also announcing this morning two opportunities for public input that are happening this month. Both are important to the quality of life of our community, and so I'm asking for the public to be engaged. Two dates each are scheduled for the Citizens Police Ombudsman Commission process and the Riverfront Park Master Planning process. Let's start with the Citizen Police Ombudsman Commission. We're on the cusp of unprecedented citizen oversight of our police department. We have updated our charter language to allow for the creation of a new independent Citizen Police Ombudsman Commission. The City Council has approved a labor contract with the Police Guild that creates three avenues for citizen independent investigation. We're working on a policy to put on body-worn cameras on our officers for later this year. Collectively, these transparency measures are good for Spokane and put us at the leading edge of police oversight and accountability regionally, statewide, and nationally. We are aggressively pursuing the formation of an independent Citizen Police Ombudsman Commission while being mindful to take the time to do it right. That includes gathering input from the community. We're also meeting with those who serve the community so well on the Use of Force Commission and the Criminal Justice Commission. I expect the new Citizen Police Ombudsman Commission will be seated this summer. Our city attorney, Nancy Isserlis, will host two public meetings this month to gather input on how it would be formed, selected, and function. Many in the community have provided input over the past several months, and that has informed the approach we take for independent citizen police oversight. We need to get even smarter as we make this community safer. Public meetings are being planned on Monday, April 28th from 12 noon to 1 p.m. and Tuesday, April 29th from 5 to 6 p.m. Both sessions will be held in the City Council Briefing Center. I encourage you to be a part of shaping how we advertise, evaluate our candidates, and select the members of this first independent Citizen Police Commission, Ombudsman Commission. Discussion topics will include the desired characteristics of individual commissioners and the makeup of the commission as a whole. We will specifically emphasize diversity and inclusion. Application materials and process, level of background check requirement for chosen applicants, and public record issues involved in the process will also be discussed during these meetings. Recommendation and input will be compiled and forwarded to me and the City Council by early May. Spots on the commission will be advertised through May. Applicants will be due early June, and expectation the commissioners would be seated by late July. So we are continuing the process in earnest to implement the citizens' objective of an oversight committee of our police department. And again, I asked Nancy Easterlis, the city attorney, to spearhead this, and working in conjunction with our city council and many others that have been following this issue for the last months and in many cases for the last several years. Thank you, Nancy. All right, the next one. Don't worry, bikers, you're up, not next. The next one's River Park. Great to have you guys all here. Joining me today are several that have been key in the development of the next Riverfront Park, and we'll start here now. We are in the middle of that process of planning for the future of Riverfront Park. Riverfront Park has served quite literally as our front yard for so many years, the past four decades. A volunteer advisory committee has spent the last year evaluating its current offerings and thinking about the future. Quite literally, the next 40 years. The Riverfront Park Master Plan Advisory Board has come up with several great ideas and recommendations that are ready to share with the community. The Spokane Park Board will host two public comment sessions this month to discuss recommendations on a new and existing park uses. Those meetings will be held Thursday, April 17th and Thursday, April 24th. Both will begin at 6 p.m. in the Council Chambers at City Hall. Free parking is available at the Riverfront Park lots for participants coming to testify and to give their input. Ted McGregor, who chaired the advisory committee, will make a formal presentation to the Park Board on the evening of April 17th. The advisory committee and its 19 volunteer members have met monthly with the park staff and board members since April of last year. They concluded their work last month. Their recommendations will make River Park even stronger and draw more of our neighbors and visitors to our front yard. Advisory committee recommendations and design concepts developed during the past year are posted on the master plan website at riverfrontparkmasterplan.org. Again, it's all one word like they all are, riverfrontparkmasterplan.org. While we gather input from the community, we're also looking at how to provide sustainable funding. We expect to provide details on that proposal in the coming weeks that will meet important needs of our parks and our streets. And we're considering ways to refinancing existing resources to create enough funding to pay for ongoing street improvements and implement the Riverfront Park Master Plan. The proposal will likely include a package of bonds, levies, and possibly other financing tools. Most importantly, it will achieve greater value for our community without asking citizens to reach deeper in their pockets. We think there is an opportunity to leverage current interest rates, financial conditions, and financial conditions much the same way homeowners have done by refinancing their mortgages and restructuring their debt. We have a little work to do, to put the finishing touches on a proposal before we come to the public, and also asking for the public's input. With that, I'll turn it over to Ted or to the chairman of the board, Randy Cameron, if you have any comments.
I'm Ted McGregor, and the mayor's right. Actually, on Thursday night when we present our report, it'll be 364 days since our first meeting. We've had an amazing process. We didn't dilly-dally. We got a lot of things done. We had spirited debates. Everybody loves this place. This is our common ground. The mayor calls it our living room. And we found a lot of common ground in our process. So it's pretty remarkable. There's a lot of things that a lot of people have been thinking about this park for years. And I think we're finally putting them into a funnel, and we're gonna present them to the community in a way that makes sense and, you know, prepare this place for the next 40 years. Here in another few weeks, we're all gonna be celebrating the World's Fair's 40th anniversary. And so the timing's great for that, to take a look at, you know, the future. A lot of people put in a lot of time and effort 40 years ago to make this place what it is, and it falls to our generation to take the next step and keep the ball rolling and make it a beautiful place that allows Spokane to stand out. So I have in my hand the rough draft. There are some typos here. I'm going to hand this off to the mayor and give him a little bit of a sneak peek before Thursday night's event. So hope to see you all there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And again, we'll have those time to get the citizen engaged in this process this month. So it's going to be a busy month for our citizens. Thanks again, guys, for joining us here this morning. And of course, any of the media, if you have specific questions for any of those that are involved in today's briefing, of course, they'll be available here shortly. With that, here we go, bikers. Come on up. Let's go. So now you know where the press conference was, right? Was it good that I was a little late? I found a biker on the trying to find out where we are. We weren't in our regular place. But anyway, finally this morning, we have a fun way for people to get involved with Bike to Work Week in Spokane, which is May 12th through the 16th. Commute of the Century is a group ride or self-guided tour of Spokane's bicycle infrastructure over 6 routes across the city. This ride is meant for all riders, including those newly interested in commuting, somewhat experienced or well-seasoned to riding Spokane streets. People can choose to participate at their own pace and on their own schedule. We'll also ask participants to opt into a survey of each route. We want feedback on comfort, sense of belonging, ease of use, wayfinding, completeness, and other important elements of the cycling experience. For the goal-oriented type, you can earn the prestigious Commute Centurion Award. This means completing the full 6, that means all 6 routes and accompanying surveys. I'm going to turn it over to Brandon, who will give us a few more details about this awesome opportunity for our bicyclists.
Thank you, Mayor. The Commute of the Century, like he mentioned, is an opportunity for us to get a sense of comfort and quality that our bicycle infrastructure provides for the citizens. So we can look at a map and we can provide a network of bike lanes and facilities, but those may not serve the general public in the same way because everybody has a different sense of what cycling should be or is, you know, and so everyone has a different comfort level out there. So I'd like to thank our sponsor, Eye Consultants, and Dr. Gary Fillmore, who's helping provide the background funding to pull this event together. And it should be a great opportunity. Again, this is going to be a supported group ride during Bike to Work Week. And if you can't come during that time, we still want your public comments. So you can take and do the ride on your own schedule until before July 31st.
Thanks, Brandon. And again, another opportunity for those as part of Spokane Gives Week was the big countywide bike swap this last weekend. So I'm sure there'll be a lot of new bikers that might be out there on the routes. And again, thanks for joining us here today. And for the media, if you have any questions, I'm sure they'd be excited to answer them, right? And with that, I'll take questions. Those of you guys that want to stay here during question period, you can stay back here. Or if you want to get interviewed, you can do that. So I'll take any questions from the press.
The Fish Lake Trail, when's it going to be finished?
Fish Lake Trail, Brandon, can you answer that one?
I can try to answer that one. So the Fish Lake Trail, we're actually going to be building another 1.5 miles about this summer, extending out to Queen Lucas Lake. The next segment of that, though, has a big gap in terms of we have to cross the railroad tracks, and it's going to be costly to build the bridges over that. So we're still several years out before we'll be able to get the funding in place for that, but gives you a sense of where we're going.
It's great to be adding that piece this year, and you can see what that connection in our Centennial Trail has done for our community just here, just to the west of us. And so it'll be exciting to add that also to Fish Lake Trail.
Mayor, can you or the city attorney give us a sense of the format of these meetings on the OPO Commission? Will there be time for just free public comment?
yes. The city attorney's right behind you if you want to ask her specifically about how she's going to run it. Frankly, we thought it most effective if the mayor stayed out of those community meetings. The ultimate goal for the commission is to be independent of the political office of the mayor. And so on that spirit, that is why I selected Nancy to do that. And so she'll be setting those up, and you can talk to her specifically of how the agenda is going to run in those meetings. But yes, the purpose of them is for public comment.
So you keep saying that you want to make Spokane the most compassionate city. What is it going to take to do that?
What is it going to take to make the city the most compassionate in America? Well, I'll tell you, it is key as we look at the interactions of acts of compassion. And so that's why when you go to Spokane Gives, you're asked to register. And as we build out the hours of volunteer work, the hours and commitment of our citizens, I believe that gives us the stand to show literally how much acts of compassion our community produces over that week-long period to allow us to take on some of our sister cities, whether it be Louisville or Seattle, which are also compassion cities. And so the compassionate movement is an international movement of cities, of engagement of their citizens in acts of service and acts of compassion.
What do they do differently that we need to change?
Well, I'll tell you, my good friend Greg Fisher in Louisville, I believe last year had over 50,000 volunteer or acts of compassion. So we're going to see how we do this year as we're tracking them. And so as we go to get those acts, that's where we should be. So we're putting that together now on to see what our baseline is this year. And like I said, we've already doubled the efforts this just on Saturday alone. We have over 100 different activities. But really, I mean, we had the bikers here today, great activities on our trail systems. The county is participating in this, and there's a big effort to clean up the trails there in the Dishman area. So we have many different events that are happening, but also getting those volunteers to come, or quite frankly, the big bike swap. Over 250 volunteers are needed to put that on to get the next generation of bikers in affordably. So I think we have the right pieces, and we'll see how we are this year and then put an action plan together to get there over the next year.
Okay, so what's the timeline like?
The timeline for, I would see over the next year, April is National Service Month, Volunteer Month, and so we have another great opportunity as we work over the next year to put together a plan to even take it to the next level like we did this year. Any other comments or questions? All right, it's great to be here. We'll see you out there this week on all the great activities happening.